Hello, RSA Conference community. I'm Cecilia Marinier, Program Manager for Innovation and Scholars at RSA Conference. I have the good fortune to work with Beau Woods, who is also a member of DEFCON Biohacking Village. With the recent attack that happened, on the UHS hospital system, I thought it'd be a great time to check in with Beau and find out a little bit more about what you know and what you can tell us about what happened and the consequences of it.
Sure.
So actually, before we get started though, Beau, can you give a small brief introduction to yourself? Sorry about that.
Yeah, sure. Hi, my name is Beau Woods. I am part of the Biohacking Village, the nonprofit that works together with the healthcare community and all of the stakeholders, security researchers, medical device makers, hospitals, the FDA, in order to ensure that we have a better public trust in public health system and to ensure that we have healthier tech and healthier people.
Excellent. All right. So then getting back to the current attack on UHS's hospital system, can you share with us what you know right now and what's going on?
Sure. It appears that over the weekend, the UHS hospital system, which is one of the largest in the United States, was hit with a ransomware attack. A lot of the systems are down, some of them proactively, some of them reactively. In other words, some of the systems that have been taken offline have been impacted by ransomware. It appears from some of the anecdotal reporting that we have that some of them were taken offline by the healthcare group themselves in order to prevent the spread of ransomware, which is a fairly standard approach when you're trying to stay ahead of something that can move as quickly and as instantaneously as ransomware.
So what? So one of the things that we know about this is they are not the first hospital that has been attacked. In fact, recently they in Germany, there was a similar attack that led to a woman's death. And this is actually putting us on the front lines between, in general, in cyber attacks, we haven't really seen this merge of life and death, but this is actually the first time they're attributing an attack that led to this woman's death. And how they said it was that she had to be rerouted because the hospital was under attack. What is your perception or what is your understanding of these kinds of attacks and the threats that they have and what they might evolve to look like going forward?
Yeah, when a hospital is hit with a type of disruption like this, whether it comes from accidents or adversaries, then some of their critical systems are offline, usually things like electronic health records, lab equipment, radiology imaging. Some of the things that provide doctors the information they need to make rapid decisions in life and death, critical time-bound situations. In the case you mentioned in Germany, a hospital was essentially down because of a ransomware incident. A patient who apparently had a stroke was coming to the hospital and they were diverted to another healthcare provider. And this is a fairly regularly practiced thing at healthcare facilities. They'll reroute if their hospital gets too full or if they feel like they can't provide the best care available to the patient that's coming in, whether they're at full capacity, full operating capacity or not. So this patient was rerouted to a different hospital and died on the way. Now, it's careful. We have to be careful what we interpret this to be. Mm-hmm. So, the ransomware didn't kill the patient. The underlying issue killed the patient, right? The stroke itself is what ultimately killed the patient. But as we know in other studies that were conducted around marathons, where they looked at delay in providing care to critically injured patients like this, a small delay, 4.4 minutes on average, resulted in a statistically significantly higher mortality and morbidity rate in these instances. So in other words, a 4-minute delay has been shown to cost lives. And in certain situations, if you get diverted to a different healthcare provider, the timeline can be much longer than 4 minutes. So we should mm-hmm. expect these types of things to happen. Now, while the German situation appears to be the first time that this has been directly reported on, that there mm-hmm. is a case where someone directly died in this manner on the way on diversion from one healthcare provider to another, we can assume that this type of thing is not the first time it's ever happened. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that that we've kind of called on is for there to be some investigations into the frequency of harm that comes from either ransomware attacks or direct impact to medical devices or other situations. As we, as you well know, when we have done over a few years ago, clinical simulations on the RSA stage, a small delay or a small disturbance in care delivery can sometimes make the difference between life and death. And that's kind of altering what we typically expect if we go into work in a cybersecurity environment, right?
Right.
Where most of our efforts over the last 20 years or so have been focused on intellectual property theft, on financial fraud, on other data-related crimes, where you're concerned about the confidentiality of data. Here we have a situation where the asset you're trying to protect is human life and public safety, and you're more concerned about the availability and integrity of systems. And so there's a fundamental difference between those two outlooks and those two approaches to how we defend against those two types of potential issues.
I'm telling you, Beau, this has just been an incredible time, and it's really unbelievable how much crossover is happening between what we're, you know, as technology becomes more embedded into all of our lives, whether you're talking about critical infrastructure, you're talking about medical devices, or you're talking just about financial systems. I mean, it is everywhere. It is so pervasive. And I think it makes it the field so much broader. So instead of leaving on a kind of down note, I want you to talk positively about, you know, how some of these people who work with you at the Biohacking Village are doing some amazing work, and share with us a success story.
Yeah. So some of the successes coming out of healthcare are absolutely amazing right now. Partly because of the COVID pandemic and the need for everyone to stay socially distanced. The amount of telehealth that's happening right now is just astounding. Where previously telehealth was not a reimbursable item for doctors. So they were less likely to provide a telehealth service. Now it's being reimbursed by Medicare, Medicaid, and by insurance companies. And for those who aren't up on the latest on telehealth, it's like having a doctor's visit in your own home rather than having to travel. So it increases the amount of people seeking care. It allows them to seek care earlier than they would have otherwise, which improves outcomes dramatically. And it drastically lowers the amount of time that they spend getting to and from the doctor's office, the amount of time that the doctors have to spend, have to wait. So there's enormous benefits to telehealth. And that's just one example of what's happening in the world of healthcare that has me looking forward past the COVID pandemic to some of the brand new capabilities, some of the brand new approaches that we may be taking in healthcare that might leave us better off than we were before. It's the silver lining, if you will.
Love it. Love it. Well, thank you very much for your time today, Beau. I hope you have a wonderful evening. And to the rest of the RSA conference community, please look at all the different opportunities to learn more about what is happening in this field through our library.